Good morning, students. So today we will talk about adverse drug reaction. Under this heading, we will talk about metabolism interaction, the role of induction and inhibition of cytochrome P450 enzymes, and we will also talk about spontaneous case reporting and record linkages. So let's start with metabolism interaction. So what are metabolism interaction? When one drug interacts with the metabolism of other drug, it is called as metabolism interaction. So the metabolism of major drugs generally take place in liver, but then there are other organs that also help in metabolism. Example, WBCs, skin, lung and GIT. So now let's talk about cytochrome CYP stands for cytochrome P450. Cytochrome P450 family is the major metabolizing enzymes in phase 1. So these are two phases of hepatic metabolism. Hepatic means the liver, the metabolism which is caused by liver. So it generally takes place in two phases, that is phase 1 and phase 2. But the first one is called as modification, the next one is called as conjugation. Now, as we know that cytochrome P450 is most important isoenzyme and is responsible for liver metabolisms. So there are many types of CYP450 enzymes. For example, CYP3A4, CYP2D6 and 2C8. Now, in this pie chart, as you can see, these are the proportion of drugs metabolized by P450 enzyme. Now, 36% of the drugs are metabolized, that is the major portion, are metabolized by CYP3A4, 5. Then the next one is CYP2D6 and then CYP1A or CYP12 and so on. Now let's talk about enzyme induction and enzyme inhibition. First we'll talk about induction. So there are two types of drugs. The first one is object drug and the other one is precipitant. So this precipitant drug causes enzyme induction. Induction means to increase the level of the enzyme in the body. Now, if the enzyme which causes metabolism of object drug is increased, it will simply mean that it will lead to an early excretion of drug from the body, and therefore the desired pharmacological action will not be achieved. Now, if we'll talk about enzyme inhibition, so this precipitant also causes enzyme inhibition. Inhibition means that it inhibits the enzyme from acting. So, if the enzyme which was responsible for metabolism of this object drug is not there, that simply means that this drug will cause accumulation in the body, and hence toxicity. Now, moving on. Now, we'll see some examples of enzyme induction. These are the object drugs, these are the precipitant drug and the influence, that is the result. For example, we'll take the case of barbiturates. Barbiturate increases the enzyme production. Which enzyme? The enzyme which causes the metabolism of these drugs. Which drugs? Oral contraceptive, coumarins and tolbutamide. Now, if the enzyme is induced, that means it is produced in large amount, then the pharmacological action that was expected from these drugs will not be achieved, or will be achieved in a level lower than what we initially wanted. The influence will be decreased plasma level, leading to decreased efficiency of the object drug. Right? The same goes on with phenytoin. Phenytoin is the precipitant drug. Phenytoin will induce the enzyme metabolizing theophylline, cyclosporine and oral contraceptives. Similarly, rifampicin and the same drugs. Now, this slide shows how rifampicin increases metabolism of cyclosporine by inducing CYP3A4 enzymes. So, cyclosporine, these are the serum level of cyclosporine and these are the time in days. Okay, so here a patient goes for a heart transplant and the cyclosporine is the kind of drug which is given to decrease the person's natural immunity, because if the immunity is increased at this point of time, it may cause transplant rejection. So to minimize the chances of transplant rejection, we generally administer cyclosporin, right? So the patient here on day zero goes into heart transplantation. Then we initiate the cyclosporin dosing from I guess day two or three. We start with that. So the level of cyclosporin, the serum level increases, very nice. And then after 70 days, we also start rifampicin to the same patient, which now rifampicin will increase the level of CYP3A4 enzymes in the body, which will cause early metabolism of cyclosporin. So if now because of rifampicin, the level of cyclosporin in the body decreases. As you can see, this line shows the level of cyclosporin in the body. It decreases because of rifampicin. Now, because the level of cyclosporin is decreased, that means the person's natural immunity will increase, and hence it will cause transplant rejection. Now let's talk about enzyme inhibition. So these are the object drug, precipitant drug, and influence, that is the result. Now this example here is both important and interesting. So the patient who are suffering from chronic alcoholism are generally treated with disulfiram. So what happens here is that alcohol is the object drug and disulfiram is the precipitant drug. So what disulfiram does is that it inhibits the enzyme responsible for metabolism of alcohol. So because the enzyme which is responsible is inhibited, so the level of alcohol in the body will increase. Now alcohol will be converted into acetaldehyde. Now acetaldehyde produces disulfiram like reaction, which simply means that the patient would feel, whenever he takes alcohol, would feel intense flushing, headache, nausea, vomiting, and therefore it will ultimately lead him to stop taking alcohol. Moving on. Now this is a very important and interesting slide. This here shows induction of CYP3A4 and inhibition of CYP3A4. Now induction is by rifampicin and St. John's wort, whereas inhibition is by itraconazole. Now when a patient takes rifampicin or St. John's wort, that's not, we all know rifampicin, but St. John's wort is a herbal medicine. Now when we take these medicines in presence of cyclosporin, it causes induction of CYP3A4 enzyme, which causes accelerated cyclosporin elimination. Induction means increasing the enzyme level of enzyme. When the enzyme level is increased, it causes accelerated elimination. Therefore, it will ultimately lead to transplant rejection. Now, this is the kind of example which we have already taken in the last slide when we saw that graph. Now here, when itraconazole is administered in presence of cyclosporin, it causes inhibition of CYP3A4 enzyme. Now this inhibition causes delayed cyclosporin elimination, which ultimately causes cyclosporin nephrotoxicity. Now we'll talk about excretion interactions in brief. The most drugs are excreted in urine or bile. Now some drugs are reabsorbed from renal tubules or enterohepatic recirculation. Some drugs are excreted in acidic urine, so changing the urine pH will affect these serum levels. Now these interactions are rare, and how are these interactions taking place? By alteration in renal blood flow, alteration of urine pH, or forced diuresis. So let's talk about what are the various methods for detecting drug interaction. So the first one is pharmacovigilance, the second is drug interaction profile fingerprints, and the third is computer aided prescribing. So let's talk about pharmacovigilance. Whenever a drug is introduced in the market, it generally goes through a very comprehensive clinical trials, and when it is introduced, it is called as post-marketing surveillance, where pharmacovigilance plays an important role. So during this phase, when the drug is introduced into the market and the people all over the world are using it, so during that period, we generally find out a lot about the adverse drug reactions and what are the various drug interactions. Now the second one is drug interaction profile fingerprint. Now this is the kind of technology which is very new right now, and a lot of studies are going on to get to know more about this fingerprinting styles. The third one is computer aided prescribing. Computer aided prescribing has been in the market for a long time. So for example, when a physician is prescribing medications, let's say he is prescribing cyclosporine with itraconazole. So whenever he prescribes medication using a computer and the software, the computer aided prescribing software, it will ultimately pop up a window for it shows that these two drugs are interacting, and it gives doctor a warning that he is prescribing these two drugs, and whether and it also gives doctors the options that he can either decrease the dose and so on. Now let's talk about spontaneous case reports. When a physician recognizes a drug interaction, it is his responsibility to report it directly to the company or to the regulatory authority. The main limitation is of underreporting. When a physician becomes aware of a serious adverse drug reaction, healthcare providers, pharmacies, pharmaceutical companies shall report it to the health authority. The time frame is generally of a very specific of a serious ADR is 7 days. Now, what are the reporting methods and template? It shall be reported as a post, a fax, or internet, or via internet. A verbal report is acceptable in urgent situations, but a written submission should be completed before deadline. Additional information on serious ADR reports not available at the time of initial report should be provided in follow-up reports, like when a physician orders a blood test or any kind of test which the report is not available yet, but it will come in the near future. So he should give all those reports into the follow-up report. Now moving on to the record linkage. As the name suggests, record and linkage. So the two or three records are linked together to produce a sustainable evidence to show that there is drug interaction. So what does it do? It brings together a variety of patients' record. An example is of prescription event monitoring scheme. It is less expensive, but it is very time consuming. So thank you. That's all about adverse drug reactions and drug interactions. Thank you so much for your time.